Broadcasting live from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a guy who travels so he can pretend he's on the lam, Pete Schwaba.
Welcome back. Our question tonight is, what song do you hear that immediately makes you think of a movie? What song do you hear that immediately makes you think of a movie? 855-752-4842, 855-75-CIVIC. Bridget checks in on the text line from the 818. She says, Summer Nights, the best movie song, defined my childhood. She's talking about, of course, do you know that one?
I don't know that I do.
Grease.
Oh.
Yeah, Summer Nights, Summer Lovin'.
Yeah, I should have known that.
Yeah, that's a very... Pardon me. I'm having some kind of attack here. That's a very identifiable song. That's a great one. Thank you, Bridget. All right. So Emerson, I suckered Emerson into hanging out for a little while longer because we're having so much fun here. He's in studio. Emerson Lehmann from WBAY. He is the co-host of The Morning Show and having a blast here in Green Bay, which is cool. And I needed some journalistic support because I'm bringing another journalist onto the show. I'm surrounded. And Conrad's got my back, but he's not. I don't know. He's looking for new movie clips already. So, all right, it's my pleasure to welcome to Nite Lite again, one of my favorite guests from the Capital Times in Madison, entertainment reporter Rob Thomas. Hey, buddy.
Hey, Pete. How are you?
Very good. Thank you. Meet Emerson Lehmann.
Rob, pleasure.
Hey, Emerson. So you got a real roundtable going here tonight.
I love that phrase. Yes, we have a roundtable. Did you ever see the Simpsons episode, Rob, where Homer skips church, and instead of being punished, everything goes great? And one of the lines they say, we interrupt this political roundtable discussion to bring you a football game. And he starts dancing around. That's my favorite use of the phrase, roundtable. Rob, how are you?
I'm great. A little tired. I had the film festival here in Madison, so we were going pretty hard for eight days. But yeah.
I cut out after about 4 days, and you stuck it out the whole time. You were part of, I believe, did you end up going last night to Alexander Payne?
I did. Yeah. It was great. He did. He showed this film he'd wanted to see, this 1950 film called The Long Haul, but then he showed Sideways, which is like maybe his best known movie. I mean, pretty close, right?
I would say
for his 20th anniversary screening, at the Barrymore, so it was a big crowd. It was probably 700-800 people.
Oh wow, nice.
Yeah, and he talked about it afterwards on stage and kind of the making of it. And it was really fun. That movie is so funny. Like
it's great.
Remembered how well acted it was. I remembered how, you know, the good the characters were and like sort of the drama, but it was just so funny. And like in an audience, it was a great time. Like people were really laughing. Yeah.
For those of you that might not know, Alexander Payne is the director, writer, or co-writer of Holdovers, which was nominated for Best Picture this year. And he won an Oscar. Did he win for Best Director on Sideways? I think he did.
I don't know. I don't know.
Okay. But either way, he's the filmmaker. Sideways is a great film starring Paul Giamatti, Thomas Hayden Church, Virginia Madsen. I loved it. I didn't like it as much as Election, just because I thought Election was funnier, but Paul Giamatti is amazing in every role he does. Rob, what did Alexander Payne say about it? Did he talk about his cast at all last night? Could the general public ask questions?
Yeah, and one thing about casting was interesting was that the studio was really pushing him to cast some big stars in Sideways, and they wanted Edward Norton for the Paul Giamatti role, which I cannot really pick. Yeah. I cannot really picture. And I guess George Clooney really wanted to play the Thomas Hayden Church role.
Really?
But Payne just kind of stuck to his guns, and he had auditioned Giamatti Hayden Church and said, these are the guys. And he made a movie with Clooney a few years later called The Descendants, also a really good movie, but much more of a drama. And so I think that's, you know, like you say, like those guys are just perfect together, and you know, oil and water, they're just, even though that like they're not great guys, they don't make great decisions,
right.
But they're so funny and so pathetic, you know,
right.
that it makes you kind of root for them, even though you kind of also want to see them get what's coming to them.
Well, yeah. And it, Clooney would have been a weird cast too, because Thomas Hayden Church played a down and out actor. He was kind of, you know, clinging to his career. Clooney was still a huge movie star at the time. I don't know if people would have bought that. Right.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And yeah, I mean, Hayden Church was just perfect as sort of this, yeah. You know, he still had, you could tell he still had the haircut from 20 years ago. He's sort of like surfer right. guy haircut, even right. though his face was all craggy. And I just cannot see Edward Norton as the Paul Giamatti role. Like, I just don't see him. I don't see how he could play that sort of, you know, loser, but sort of, you know, you sort of feel for him, even though he's sort of getting in his own way.
Right.
He's just too intense an actor to, I think, to really pull that off and be sympathetic, but maybe I'm wrong. Yeah.
No, I agree. And I picture, okay, the most famous line probably in the film is they're wine snobs, and Paul Giamatti's character is offered Merlot and he almost yells, "I am not drinking effing Merlot." I can't see Edward Norton saying that line.
No, I can see him saying it, but saying it in a way that's very scary and like, oh my goodness, put away the Merlot. He's going to go nuclear, you know?
Right.
But and that got such a huge reaction in the audience last night. Like, I think people even applauded because it was such,
that's so cool.
But there's so many good lines in that and great sight gags, like the guy, the naked guy at the end who chases Paul Giamatti. And do you remember that?
I don't.
So at the end, Thomas Hayden Church sleeps with a waitress he meets.
Yeah.
The waitress is married. And so Thomas Hayden Church runs out of his house, but leaves his wallet behind. Paul Giamatti agrees to sneak in and try and get it. And he's chased out by the guy's husband, right. who is this big guy, totally naked. And Alexander Payne said that, like, so in the scene, like, Paul Giamatti jumps in his car and the guy runs up to the car. And apparently in the first take, the guy, his gut hit the side window, shattered it, covered Paul Giamatti with broken glass. And luckily he was fine.
Oh,
and able to find another window and finish the scene. But like, he said that was the hardest day of filming, was worrying that a naked guy's gut had sliced up his lead actor.
That's the kind of stuff like that you only get from Q&A's at film festival, you know, like those behind the scenes thing. Rob, Alexander Payne did win an Oscar with Jim Taylor for best writing adapted screenplay for Sideways. So
excellent.
I knew they won something.
I knew
they
got a writing somewhere, but yeah, I'm not sure which one. Yeah.
So you wrote an article, I think for the Cap Times, maybe it was your Substack, about Tingler.
Yeah.
The Vincent Price movie. Tell us about that. I was sorry I didn't get to see that one. That was really cool. And they had a gimmick involved in it as well.
Yeah, that was really fun. So the Tingler was this Vincent Price movie from the 50s. And it was, you know, a sci-fi horror movie where allegedly there are these creatures called Tinglers, that, like centipedes that live in your body and feed on fear. And the director was this guy who was like a showman who would come up with all these gimmicks to try and get people into the theater. And so apparently he would rig the seats in the theater with something called Percepto, which was, I think, basically like a joy buzzer. To sort of go off when the Tingler was nearby on screen. And so for the festival, they found somebody who could rig the seats to do this. And I interviewed the guy. He was like kind of a modern day showman. He wouldn't really reveal his secrets about how he was doing it. But I went to the screening and I knew where the seats were that had the Tingler attached to it. It was a blast. It was so much fun. And everybody was screaming and laughing, and it was you know, I mean, it was more of a vibrator than a Tingler, but I can understand why they didn't call it the vibrator.
Did anybody have an accident? I'd be worried. I'd be that guy. Like that, I'd be sitting nobody, in one of the seats. And I wet
nobody
myself
admitted to it. It was not an unpleasant feeling. Nobody would admit to actually. Yeah, it was at the end of the movie too, so that would have been a problem. But nobody admitted to it. It was a very fun thing, and you know, very, you know, the Wisconsin Film Festival is not Sundance or Cannes. I think they're always looking for fun things to do like that. So sort of, yeah. You know, and that's one of the great things about it.
My guest is Rob Thomas. He is the entertainment reporter, one of them for the Capital Times and a favorite of ours here. Rob, will you be, Emerson used to work in Milwaukee. We did do 5 years there.
2 years.
2 years in Milwaukee. Did you get to the Milwaukee Film Festival?
I didn't. Oh, okay. It's a bummer that I didn't.
It's a good one. Are you going there at all, Rob? Are you covering Milwaukee?
I don't think so. I'm going out of town next week. And it started the last day of the Madison Festival.
Yeah.
And I was pretty burned out by the Madison Festival. There's some good stuff definitely at the Milwaukee one.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously beautiful theaters like the Oriental or they're using venues. The Denver this year, I guess. But if I had the stamina, I might try and hit a couple there. But are you going, Peter?
I haven't been invited, Rob. So what does that tell you about where my
horrible oversight?
Yeah, their festival goes for 2 weeks, too, which I kind of like. It gives you a little like Wisconsin is so intense the first few. And I like that, too. There's like this vibrancy about it, you know, and trying to see as many films as you can.
And these are new and old movies or kind of a mix of everything or
all of the above. Okay. Like with Wisconsin, I know, and Milwaukee does this, too. They restore old classics. They'll show those. They'll show new independent films. They'll have like Sideways there. Oh, yeah. They do great. I mean, the stuff. Have you been to all the film festivals in the state, Rob, or several over the years?
I've been to several. Beloit has one going on at the same time.
That's supposed to be a good one, too.
Yeah. It's sort of like in restaurants and bar, you know, sort of wherever they can find space.
Yeah.
A very lit neighborhood one. So I've been to those three. I don't know of any other ones like up north, but Green Bay has one. I know.
Yeah.
I've not been to that one, but they're kind of a big thing now because it's like, especially when, you know, frankly, movie theaters, the big ones aren't showing these smaller films as much.
Right.
It's a great way to get people together, especially when it's maybe a little chilly out for a week and
absolutely
and see some great movies. Yeah.
It's great to see them too in the venues. I love, and I haven't been to all the Milwaukee theaters, but those are great. Wisconsin showed one in the music hall. They made a makeshift theater that was beautiful. The Barrymore is an old classic theater that's beautiful. I saw a couple things there this year. It's just so much fun. My guest is Rob Thomas. We'll have more with Rob. I'm going to find out what Rob is watching. I hope you got my list, Rob.
I did.
All right, perfect. We'll do that next. This is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, Emerson Lehmann hanging out. This is the Civic Media Radio Network. Steve from Florida checking in. It says the Eye of the Tiger from Rocky. Yeah, that's about as spot on as Summer Nights as well with Grease. That's a great one, Steve. Rob Thomas is my guest right now. We are talking Wisconsin Film Festivals. Emerson Lehmann from WBAY, our morning co-anchor here in Green Bay, has joined us and been nice enough to hang around for a little while. And join me in my discussion because I need to tag team when I talk to Rob. I can't keep up intellectually or on a lot of levels, but I keep changing the show times on him and all kinds of stuff. So
I'm here.
You're here. Hey, so you wrote something, Rob, I can't remember if it's the Substack or the Capital Times, but it's good to know I'm reading you on every platform you're on.
I appreciate it. Yeah. It's
yeah.
My media empire.
I like all your
different
stuff.
Tentacles.
Yeah. Michael Showalter, the idea of you, I had no idea. As you may or may not remember, in The Godfather of Green Bay, Tom Lennon was in there. He was one of the founding members of the state. So
yeah.
I did not know this guy was, I didn't know much about the state, to be honest with you, but man, the talent that has come out of that group is incredible.
Yeah. I mean, and these are the guys who did Wet Hot American Summer, which
yeah.
is like a classic movie,
one of Conrad's parody. Favorites.
Yes.
Yeah. And gosh, Thomas Lennon, Michael Ian Black, Ken
Nisi
Marino,
Nash. David Blake,
yeah.
Yeah.
All these guys have gone Incredible. On. Yeah. And so Michael Showalter, though, who who I think was like the lead in Wet Hot American Summer. He's become a director, and his films have been pretty sincere, like rom-coms and dramedy. He's like called the king of the dramedy now.
Yeah.
So they said I could interview him about this new Anne Hathaway movie, The Idea of You, which was at the festival. I think it's going to be on Prime Video like early May.
Oh, May 2nd. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. It's a great interview. He's really interesting. He's really thoughtful about these kind of movies. And it's interesting. He's not, so the state is like doing a reunion tour right now.
Yeah.
But he's not part of it. And he told me that, like, I think he's just kind of overperforming. He said he didn't rule that out, but like, it's just not really where he's at anymore as a, 50-year-old guy probably stays in the 90s on MTV. So it's kind of interesting because I sort of assume like it was going to be, I'm mad at this guy or that guy, or not, you know, something like that, some typical Hollywood thing, but it was more like a sincere, like, yeah, I'm just not into it anymore. And, you know, so.
That's cool. He's definitely found his niche. I mean, pound for pound, the state is right up there with SCTV or Second City. I mean, in terms of who they've churned or what their group has gone on to do, I would say that's really impressive track
record. Yeah. I'd agree with that. Yeah.
So what are you watching, Rob?
Well, I've been kind of inching along because of the festival, watching more Shogun, which I don't know if we discussed last time, but that show is incredible. Like, I cannot believe that's on television. It's so good. You know what I mean? And
it's network TV, right? It's like FX, I think.
FX.
I'm like five episodes into cable? It. Yeah. Basic cable. I think
we're three or four, and like, it just keeps delivering. It's incredible. Yeah.
It's good, but you can't go to sleep on it because it's got subtitles. And sometimes subtitles, like, you can't have your phone in your hand. You look down and it's like, wait, what just happened? Who's this guy?
They're keeping you locked in by doing that.
I think that's right. True. And it's you know, and the scenery is gorgeous too. It's
What was the title again?
Shogun.
Shogun. Yeah. Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
It's good.
Large cast of characters to keep track of. And
yes. Little, there's like five tribes. Yeah.
Yep. The five houses. Yeah. It's great.
Yeah.
I watched a little of the show on, I think it's on Showtime, but it's also says Showtime on Paramount Plus. I can't tell as they're merging, but it's called, A Gentleman in Moscow with Ian McGregor. Cause, I interviewed the author of the book, Amor Tolls, cause he's coming to Madison at the end of the month. And that's really good too. It's really interesting, about this guy, a nobleman in Russia during the communist revolution. He's basically held in house arrest in this hotel for the rest of his life. And Ian McGregor's really good in it. I've only seen one episode, but that's really promising.
Yeah. I've seen the ads for it.
Yeah. And I think that's about it. People are telling me Ripley is pretty awesome on Netflix. I don't know if you've seen that.
I have. I'm like three episodes into that. And to be honest, it took a couple to, first of all, it's beautifully shot. It's in black and white. Andrew Scott is just phenomenal, the lead actor. And the third episode, there was a lot going on. Like, if you can hang in there for the first two, and it's not like it's boring. It's just like the actual Ripley-ness of it kind of doesn't really kick until the third episode. But he's
like the talented Mr. Ripley, right? This is the same story. As
same story,
yeah. Yeah. I really want to watch that. It's so interesting. Like, Shogun feels like a TV show in that, like, the end of an episode, they sort of give you a cliffhanger.
Yeah.
While these other shows sometimes, in General Moscow like that, it's kind of like watching a long movie where it doesn't have that same sort of rhythm to it. It sometimes takes a while to get going.
Oh, that's interesting. Have you seen Sugar?
I have. That's the Colin Farrell one.
Yeah, on Apple TV. It's like a PI looking for a billionaire's granddaughter who's disappeared, and they kind of splice into it Bogart movie scenes quickly, like equating Colin Farrell's PI. It's interesting. I like it so far. They drop every Friday night, so I'll have a new one tonight.
Okay.
But they've only dropped two so far, but it's good. It's well shot and written, and so far I'm into it.
Apple TV's had some good good series coming out. I'm watching Manhunt.
I'm watching that too. Yeah.
I'm probably going to go watch the next episode after I'm done with this, but they're
I got one left. Are you on, are you caught up?
I've got to watch this week's tonight. They're the one that I think last night technically it dropped, but yeah, I've been a big fan of Apple TV lately.
Yeah, same. And I like Manhunt too. I'd be curious what you think of that, Rob.
I think I'm gonna watch the first episode, maybe the first two, but yeah, it was really cool. Really interesting.
As they get closer to him, it gets a little more intense, but it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Hey, I know you got to run. Go ahead, Rob.
No, I just feel like I'm flitting around watching like an episode two here or there. I need to like commit and finish something.
Yeah. That's exactly what I've been doing. I've literally been going like Ripley, sugar. And I should just binge watch one, but it's fun to do it that way too. But I want to thank you because you made us aware of a movie called Mom and Dad's Nipple Factory, which is a very serious story. And the director is going to be on next week. He and I finally worked out a time. He's coming on. And
oh, fantastic.
Yeah. And he seems like a really cool guy. Before him, my guests are the guys from Hundreds of Beavers. So we're going to go beavers, then nipples. It just worked out that way. I did not schedule that. There's not a theme that night. So it should be a fun night.
These are the finest in Wisconsin cinema. This is, you know, this is, I'm serious.
I know you are. It's been a great year for Wisconsin. You're right. Yeah. I can't wait to see the Mom and Dad's Nipple Factory. It's supposed to be great, but I'm going to really enjoy talking to Justin. That'll be fun. So thank you again. And I know you got to go. You got dad stuff to do. So thanks for your time, buddy.
I do. I've got some chauffeuring to do. So yeah. Thanks.
Fantastic. Thanks so much, Rob.
Thanks.
You got it. That's Rob Thomas from the Capital Times. Emerson Lehmann, you can hang as long as you want.
It's been fun.
You got plans?
I'm hanging out on a Friday night. It's all good. Who's next?
Teri Barr. Right, Conrad?
Yes, and we got some music that she wants to play.
She brings awesome music. They host a show tomorrow night.
Okay.
Down at the Mothership on State Street of Civic Media. They have a live show, and it's called Live in the Lair. There's like an hour of live music, but the show is like 6 hours. They always have phenomenal, and Teri comes on to kind of promote it on Friday night. So
I don't want to steal Terry's thunder, but I'll hang out. I'll hang out and hear some music.
Emerson Lehmann going for the record. I love it. He's here. Teri Barr is coming up next on Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba on the Civic Media Radio Network. Just another lie is all that it takes to understand the difference between lovers and fakes. So baby, I talk to you in the night, in your dream of love so true. I talk.
Did you miss what's hot from Wisconsin to Hollywood? Listen to Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba podcast on civicmedia.us. You can always listen through Spotify, Apple Podcast, or the Civic Media app. Take Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba anywhere you go. Once again, here is your host, Pete Schwaba.
Welcome back. This is Nite Lite. I'm your host, Pete Schwaba. Great to have you with me on a Friday night. Emerson Lehmann from WBAY is still here. He is the co-anchor of the morning show.
You haven't shooed me away yet.
I have not shooed you away. Well, you're Conrad's friend, and Conrad said, whatever you do, keep this guy around.
Because Conrad.
He will bring value. And no, it's great to have you here, and it was fun to talk to Rob Thomas. We have another guest who I just informed Emerson Conrad that Teri was an anchor here in Green Bay. So yes. I'm excited for these two to meet. So let's bring Teri in right now because Teri Barr is like our favorite Friday night personality. She's so much fun. She joins us now. She's the host of Max Ink on Saturday nights here on Civic Media. If you haven't checked it out, you absolutely have to. It's a great show. Teri, how are you?
Hi, guys. Great to talk with you once again.
Yeah.
And hey, Emerson. He's there on a Friday night because, you know, those mornings are brutal.
Exactly. You know the tricks of the trade, Teri.
Teri, where were you on up here when you were here?
Fox 11. Fox but we 11. Were NBC okay. back at that time. Okay. Became Fox 11 halfway through my 10 years there.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, nice. Okay.
Yeah. And it was fun because I started on the morning show, so I totally get that. We were only, Emerson will love this, we were a half an hour morning show then. And now they're like 10 hours long, aren't they?
Yeah, we're on for three, so it's a little bit of a beast now.
Wow.
It is, and I'm sure you have to get there at 2 in the morning. I was lucky I didn't have to get there until 4 in the morning.
Well, sleeping in,
but
yeah.
I was only on the morning show probably a half of a year, and then I got moved to the 6 p.m., which was wonderful, and then we became the Fox station, first Fox affiliate in the country. Oh, wow. And there wasn't a big Fox, so nobody really knew what this was all about, including us working there. But we had the Packers and traveled with them all the time. And we didn't know what we were getting ourselves into, which sometimes that can be the best way to go.
Yeah. Is that like, is 6 o'clock like the sweet spot? Cause you're not up too late. You're not.
Yeah. You know? I mean, that's definitely like kind of getting all the people are, you'd like to think are home from work and everything and turn it in for their evening news with the dinner and stuff like that. I don't know.
A cocktail with a Manhattan in your hand.
It kind of depends. Like some people, they watch it in the morning.
Emerson.
Yeah. actually, I said that.
That was Pete. Emerson I can't take credit for that.
Pete.
That's okay.
I like you, Pete. I just don't want to give him a reputation.
Yeah, we're besties, but I didn't want to give him a reputation. I don't want like his bosses to be like, he's drinking a Manhattan while he's doing the news. Like, so I had to
have it in a little desk drawer underneath the table or, wherever you may need it.
My coffee mug is filled with water. I don't even drink coffee.
Right.
That's hilarious. Terry, So I wanted to ask you about this. You posted something yesterday on the company chat, a picture of you with Denise Brown. Because, O.J. Simpson passed away a couple days ago. What was that? You talked to her, you said, I think, in the chat for like an hour?
We did an hour-long special after I did a sit-down interview with her. Her sister, of course, Nicole Brown Simpson, married to O.J. Simpson. Nicole was murdered in 94. Denise Brown did her first interview with us in 1995.
Wow.
And she never, ever mentions, and she still doesn't. She does not want to say OJ's name. So her interview with us was really telling us about her sister and what her sister was going through and how she could not understand how this could happen to somebody she cared about. You know, here's Denise talking about her sister, Nicole, seeing all the signs and thinking, well, no, this cannot happen in our family. There's no way. And then, of course, she said the reality hit when Nicole was murdered in 94. Terrific interview. She then later came to Green Bay and helped raise money for the domestic abuse shelter there. And she also, since then, has gotten a little more quiet, but she has helped change some really important laws, including the big one that if you're a survivor, and by this we mean a man or a woman survivor, and the person who assaulted you is getting out of prison or jail, you get an alert immediately. So you are well aware that this person is being released. And Denise Brown was behind that happening. You know, then OJ and Nicole's kids were growing up and you know, they kept ending up in the limelight for no reason, except they were OJ's kids. So I think Denise and the family really decided to simmer everything down, quietly advocate so that those kids could try to grow up with some kind of normalcy, whatever that might be.
That's really remarkable because I forgot about her. So the fact that she has done all this behind the scenes and isn't one of those people trying to be in front of the camera all the time, for some reason that makes me even more impressed by her, you know?
Yes. I was actually stunned when we sat down to chat. She really hadn't wanted to do any interviews. She was more comfortable, you know, again, kind of behind the scenes, advocating and making a difference when it came to, can I get some bills changed? Can I just get the story out about Nicole so it doesn't happen to somebody else? But when we sat down to chat, we probably had a 4-hour interview that we cut down into the 1 hour. Wow. And at the time, Northeast Wisconsin had a really active Take Back the Night organization. And we aired this in conjunction with that April's Take Back the Night. So this is 96. And invited people to be part of it, to share their stories, to just come and, you know, kind of be in that circle of safety. And we had the biggest group we had ever had that year. And I don't know that it had anything to do with our special or Denise Brown, but because so much of that was on people's minds at that time with O.J. Simpson.
That's incredible. I'll share one more fascinating tidbit to me that I saw on Reddit regarding O.J. Simpson. And I talked about this a little bit last night on the air. The Buffalo Bills, what they have contributed to society and the horror and the tragedy. First, apparently in the season before they drafted O.J. Simpson, some guy dropped a really easy pass and they lost the game, giving them the first pick. They took O.J. Simpson, who met Nicole Brown in Buffalo. And then obviously that whole tragedy happened. And then Robert Kardashian gets involved. And we have the Kardashians now. So the Buffalo Bills, this person who posted this on Reddit said they are responsible for so much horrible stuff in America. Like, we wouldn't know the Kardashians, Nicole Brown, that never would have happened to her. Like, isn't that crazy where life can take you sometimes?
Yeah. And it's one of those, I was talking to Maggie Dawn today, and she said, what do you remember about the chase on the highway? And I said, you know, it's like September 11th. We all remember where we were when that was breaking news. And, you know, it is just one of those that you think back. It's 30 years now. But you think back, and after OJ passes a day or two ago, and realizing, oh my gosh, here we are. It's April. It's Sexual Assault Awareness Month. And OJ just passed away. Now, I don't know. To me, there was some irony in that. I don't know. Yeah. But just knowing how everybody still was sort of, OJ, oh my God, no way. He's this big, great football player, you know, larger than life. And it just became such a soap opera, except it was real.
Yeah. Well, all right. Now that we got that depressing stuff out of the way.
It was an interesting chat,
which
though,
I brought up. I apologize. It was fascinating. Yeah, absolutely. Tell us about Max Ink tomorrow. I know we have, like always, you sent us a really cool song.
Yay!
You guys have another winner. There's been no chink in the armor in the guests you've had on since I've known you.
Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. I feel really fortunate. This band, tomorrow night, they visited us a couple of times because they're one of those that tends to crank out new music and new albums constantly. They want to be on the radar. They want to be someone that finally can step out of Wisconsin and say, we did it, Wisconsin, we made it. And every time I hear a new song or a new album from them, I feel like they're right on the verge. I'm talking about the Mascot Theory. They are based in Madison. This new album coming out has been in the works. All these guys has been in the works since 2020 when we all hibernated and the band basically wrote all these songs. And then they had to wait for the country to reopen because they were scheduled to go to Sonic Ranch in Texas, middle of nowhere in southern Texas. And they were going to work with this famous producer. His name is Terry Manning. Now, Terry Manning has worked with, like, Led Zeppelin.
Familiar with their work.
ZZ Top, Lenny Kravitz. Jeez. So they were thrilled to finally get there. And in 1 week's time, they recorded all 13 songs, plus Terry Manning, like, two of their old songs. So he had them redo two of their older songs. And now they have a double album coming out in the next month. So it's really, really exciting to see them finally hit the point where they've got this music together and they can put it out to the people.
That is really cool. I just love those backstories every week when you give us some background information on the acts. So, all right, the band is called The Mascot Theory. You can hear them on Max Ink tomorrow night here at Civic Media from Live in the Lair. Conrad, let's hear their work.
Songs and they sing along. slow decay. Sometimes the story gets an ending. Will the fast car get away? Take a bow, take a bow. Take one last look around. Take a bow, take a bow. Take one last look around. Take a bow, take a bow. Take one last look around.
Was that a Conrad fade, or is that how the song
ended? That was a Conrad fade.
Terry, nice work. That's a great song.
Aren't they fabulous? Is again, that... I always say they sound radio ready, like the old days when the DJs used to be the ones that would break open careers for musicians. And I guess we hope that that can really happen for someone like this band. They do a lot of nonprofit fundraising. They do shows for free. So it's not that they don't care about the communities they live in. They do care, but it's like, I want to care more for them so that they can
do
famous, I guess.
Yeah.
I'll just say it.
Is that song? That's called Fast Car Getaway, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I want to tell you something, an experience I had with your show, and I'll do that next. This is Terry. This is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba. Emerson Lehmann sitting in. Terry Barr on the line. We're coming right back. Let It Go from Frozen on the text line from the 920. Conrad's mom checking in. That's a great song from Frozen. I would not have thought of that one, though. Terry, our song tonight, or our song, our question tonight is what song do you hear that immediately makes you think of a movie? You can take a couple minutes to think about it if you want.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
We had Eye of the Tiger, Grease, Summer Nights.
Prince.
Yeah. When Doves Cry.
1999.
That's
yeah.
A great one. Yeah.
That whole album, obviously.
Yeah. Phenomenal. Mm-hmm. All right. So let's go back to the Mascot Theory. Fast Car Getaway. Great song. I have to tell you, and I want everyone listening to know that here's what these guys do for Max Ink. I did my show last Friday from Madison, the Madison Studios, Friday and Monday. I thought I left my charger. I go back Saturday thinking I know they're going to be there setting up Live in the Lair. These guys were busting their butts, pulling cords in. I mean, what you guys do to put just to put what you into that show is incredible. Like the effort. I mean, I'm very impressed. So a tip of my hat to everything you guys do there.
Well, and last week, of course, was that big blues band, Diana Jones out of Milwaukee.
She was great.
And it's like an 8-member band. So, it takes a little bit extra when you're getting big bands like that in, but it's so worth it.
Yeah. Keep up the great work. That's a great. Hey, you do these great little reports about fun Wisconsin facts. What's the most fun one you've done recently?
It's out of Denmark, which is a little town right outside of Green Bay. There is a cheese box making company that has been there for more than 100 years.
That's the one I heard. I love this one.
Yes. And this one just made me laugh because the more you dig, the more you find.
Yeah.
And then I find out they were in this charcuterie board competition. So, you know, we come in, I think maybe it's a Wisconsin thing. We don't like to lose. So they made the biggest charcuterie board ever, and they are now in the Guinness Book of World Records.
That's something to write home about.
Absolutely.
I know. And now who's going to beat that? I don't think anybody will.
Do you think you'll be able to work the word charcuterie into any more of your exposés?
You know, if it has impressive. To do with cheese, I bet I can find a way to do it.
Yeah, you could. Yeah. Terry, thank you so much. Have a great show tomorrow night. And
And thanks to all my besties. You boys are the best.
You're our best.
Great to meet you, Terry.
Yeah.
Yeah, you too. Take care.
All right. Have a great night. You're the best.
That's a great weekend.
Terry Barr. Thank you, Terry. You too.
That song is what the kids would call a bop. Nowadays.
You know, I meant to ask her what. You're probably right, though. I usually ask her, like, how do you categorize that song?
That was a bop.
Okay.
I was bopping my head, you know?
I was tapping my foot. You were bopping. It was a bop and tap, I think, is the, you know. That was good, though. Yeah, it was a good song.
Life is a Highway by Rascal Flatts. That would be my answer to that question.
That's
my answer for Cars. Oh. Yeah.
I was thinking the same thing.
I was trying to think of it. That's a great. In the movie Cars, when they're doing that aerial shot and they're pulling out of that stadium.
And then it.
Love it.
I don't know why that this is a thing on Instagram right now, but people are making like edits to the movie Cars with.
Oh, really?
Like they're just like linking up a bunch of different scenes together and putting it to like modern music.
Oh, cool.
And, I don't know. It's awesome though. It's taken me back to.
Sounds addictive.
I think it's showing up in my algorithm now because I liked one of them and now I'm just seeing all of it.
I can't. It's so funny. Like you, I know you're older than Conrad, but when I was watching that movie with my son when it came out, I took him to the theater. I'm like, oh god, Cars, Car Town. How are they going to make this interesting? And I left. I've seen the movie 30 times. Yep. It's great.
I was supposed to have a go-kart race the day that I saw that in theaters. It got rained out, so my parents are like, okay, we'll go see Cars.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And let me tell you. Cars 1, 2, and 3, I'll watch them all.
Two?
Cars 2 gets a lot of hate. Yeah. I liked Cars 2.
Okay.
I was a fan. I'm one of the few.
Good for you. Good for you, digging your heels in.
I'll stand by that.
I like Larry the Cable Guy as Mater. You're my best friend. It was just a fun movie.
Like Tug Mater, but without the Tug or something like that.
Yeah, right. All right, so that's a good one. Life is a Highway from Cars. Andrew from Verona checks in. The 630 says, working 9 to 5. Yes, well. That's the name of the song and the movie, and it's synonymous. Absolutely. I would have to say Sympathy for the Devil in Goodfellas when they're showing all the Layla. It's the Layla song when they're showing all the dead bodies that Jimmy Conway had killed. And it was just like this bizarre kind of, they just cut all these dead bodies together and had this song that was kind of a beat. I don't know. It was bizarre.
It was a weird combination of what was going on and what you were hearing.
It's like a montage of the bodies they had killed because they pulled off a big heist.
Okay.
And guys were buying cars and fur coats, and De Niro didn't want them to get caught. So he killed them. He just took them out. And this is based on a real guy called Jimmy Conway. And it's Layla by Eric Clapton.
That sticks with you.
It sticks. Well, I mean, I have a ton. Like, I have playlists of just songs that make me think of movies.
When I walked in and I heard you mention the question, and I was like, oh, I need to start racking my brain here. I need to start thinking about it. And it finally,
there's so many though. Conrad, have you weighed in on this yet?
So I would say it's from a TV show, How I Met Your Mother, and it's called 500 Miles.
Oh, yes.
That's a good one.
Absolutely.
And it gets stuck in the tape recorder in Marshall's car, so they just keep hearing it over and over
like
and over.
A seven-hour road trip, right? And they're just jamming to that song the whole time.
It goes through phases. They're like, I hate this song. This song's so good.
That's hilarious. I like when I was working on a show. It was so bad. It was called Bandits versus Smokies. And the guys I was working for were tough to work for. It was me and another. It was me and two other writers. And all we did was put voice track to like car crashes and goofy Smokey the Bandit type cop chases.
Great movie.
Yeah. But this was not that.
Sure.
But we played a joke on this other writer. There was a song that's, I have to think what it's called, but it starts like, once there was this kid who got into an act. It was a big hit at the time, but it had this annoying lead in. We changed the guy's phone, so that was his ringer. Every time he came in, we would call him from under the desk, and he would hear it. And he got us, though, because he didn't overreact to it. He just said, stop it.
Like, wasn't really the reaction you're looking for.
No, it wasn't. We wanted him to lose his mind. He totally got the best of us. Hey, this was fun tonight, man. Thanks for coming in.
I appreciate it. Thanks for letting me hang out. It was a good time.
Always, buddy. This is a great time. Oh, also, Andrew says, just dropped in The Big Lebowski. Yes, to see what condition my condition was in. That's a great one, too. Thank you so much for your text in response to our question. Thank you to Emerson Lehmann for being here in person, Rob Thomas, and Teri Barr, and all of you participating. Just love it. So much fun on Nite Lite. We'll be back Monday. I'm Pete Schwaba. This is the Civic Media Radio Network. Good night, Wisconsin.